is they, when, once you get the two black holes to merge, the horizon, that is the separator between the inside of the black hole where all hell is breaking loose and the outside of the black hole, which is where you live, that separator is called the event horizon. And that event horizon has to form, and it doesn't form uniformly. It forms in some azimuth first, and then it makes waves that run back and forth along the horizon. Not in the horizon, and it gets sucked into the black hole, but just outside the horizon. And that makes gravitational waves, and they have a very special frequency. And the theory predicts that. We didn't see that very well. We didn't see that part, but we saw this part absolutely exquisitely. And so here, then, is the high point kind of way of describing it. This curve is the green curve here is the velocity at which these two guys are moving. And here's the velocity of light. So this is fractions of the velocity of light. And these two guys, when they get down to about there, are moving at relative speeds of 0.6 the velocity of light with things that are of the order of 30 times the mass of the sun. I mean, just imagine that thing. It's unbelievable what's going on there. And then here's the other thing is how close they got. And they got to making one Schwarzschild radius, they got down to the Schwarzschild radius of this new black hole. So, okay. Here I want to show you the two methods that actually got the data. This is the way we do the data analysis. This is actually relevant to the story. What you see here is we have two methods. One method is to just take, and you'll see that's going to be shown in this little movie, which you're going to see on the left, on the right here. What you do is you take here, so this is all faked up, don't worry about it, there's a waveform. And we'll see another waveform down here that's identical to that, because these are supposed to represent the two sites. And what we do is we scan the two site time series until they are cross-correlated, maximum cross-correlation. And then you get a time when that happens. So let me see if I can get this little movie to work. If it doesn't work, we will pass it. Okay. Yeah, see, now you can see what I'm talking about, the green thing on the bottom there. And you can see the two waveforms, one stationary on the top, the red one is the one that is sliding, and nothing much has happened yet on the one down below. But bingo, there it happened, and you see this coincidence as that's the peak signal noise in that coincidence. Okay, so, and that relates to now, this is called the generic way of looking for gravitational waves. There's nothing special. We don't look for a specific waveform. And that, here is the data, the statistics that goes with that. Here's the signal noise plotted here of that particular bump, that thing that you saw. And here is the number of events in a particular run. And here is the background. Let's not worry about this thing. That's just a subtlety. And if you care, you can ask me about it. But this curve is the more important. This is the background. It's coming down at a good rate. That's what you do it when it's not coincident. But here are the coincidences, the times of coincidences, the yellow things. And here's the event. It's just the signal noise, spectacular signal noise. There are other events, as we'll see in a minute. So that's the first method for looking for the pulses. Here's the second one, which is a much more subtle and more interesting method, which lets you look more deeply into the signal. And what you're doing now is something different. You're doing matched filtering, which is a more modern way of going at this. You're taking the cross-correlation between a signal that's buried, here, suppose this is the actual signal, with all the noise, and here is the signal that you are looking for. You think you know what it is. And so you take and pass that signal and do the cross-correlation between signal and noise against matched filter signal that you have invented. In other words, you get the idea you have a thing that's actually got no noise on it at all, but it's a theoretical prediction for that particular waveform. That means you have to have a huge number of templates. And you try, and it's very compute intensive, which it takes. It takes many days. Now we'll get faster at this. And then there it looks different. You see the signal noise is much better when we do this. And then you can try to find it. Yeah, you see this is the same sort of little presentation of this. You see the same thing on the bottom now. You'll notice that now you have a clean signal which is sweeping along where the arrow is in the upper diagram. Now they go almost coincident and bingo, there you get this thing when you're no longer multiplying the noise times the noise. That's the reason why this works so well. But it's very, very, and people are very skeptical. They say, oh, well, you're looking for something you know about. Oh, goddamn, there's nothing wrong with it. all right. And there you find something more interesting. Look what happened here. Same kind of thing, signal noise. Here's the rate of accidentals. This is the background. Again, two curves, let's not worry about that one. And here are some other things which are smaller. Here's a big guy with a single noise in this technique of about 23. And there is most likely another event right there, and maybe there. But that was too low a signal noise. We are analyzing that right now. And there may very well be another signal right about in there that happened. I won't go into that, but that's everybody in the collaboration is working on this right now. In other words, it isn't just an isolated onesie. Okay? That's important. All right. So here is sort of the thing that you get by doing this many times. You can get sort of the masks. Now there's one thing that comes out of that. If you do this with these match filters, you can get plot probability plots. For example, here's a plot of where is the signal that relative to the different models. If you say here's the mass of one black hole before they collide, here's the mass of the other black hole, and you'll see that you're talking about 35 for this guy, and maybe 30 for this one. And then here is a very interesting plot. That is what is the total angular momentum left after the collision. In other words, after the collision, they collide, and the angular momentum is now the orbital angular momentum is now in the spin of the new black hole, and here's the new mass of the new black hole. And when you look at the high best probability here, you find out an amazing fact that something like three solar masses has gone into gravitational radiation. Three solar masses. And then you divide that by that 0.1 seconds, and you find out you have something like that. You have something that is brighter than the whole universe by a factor of something like 10 to the 10, for a fraction of a second. That's all going into gravitational waves. It's the strongest thing in the world. And then here is, I won't go into that, but here's sort of the distance of this thing, 400 megaparsecs. That says it's about 1.2 billion years ago. That's where then this thing happened. Now that's still pretty close to us. The universe is 14 billion years old. So we're still within factor 10% of the size of the universe. That's close. So as we improve things, we'll probably go see things further away. Yeah. And then, I won't go into the rest of that. And that picture here tells you the unfortunate thing. It's unfortunate I can't see it so well up here. Maybe you can see it better. But this is sort of the angular patch in the sky. Here's the South Celestial Pole. And because we only have two detectors right now, we can't do better than this banana, which covers about 600 square degrees of uncertainty in the sky. So that's not a way to tell an astronomer, go search 600 square degrees. So that's why we need all those other detectors. All right, so I'm almost there. He's about to raise his hand and say, shut up. Let's not worry about that. Let's not worry about this. Let's not worry about that. I do want to tell you a little about what the field looks like. And I've virtually done except for some pictures of people who did things. And now what goes on here is that this field isn't just LIGO. I want you not to walk away that you think LIGO is the whole story. Here's LIGO. This is what you're seeing here is frequency. And this is the H values, and these are different. This goes all the way from 10 to the 4 hertz, or second, 10 minus 4 seconds, down to times that are of the order of 14 billion years. That's over here. So everything's compressed, and these H values run over 20 orders of magnitude. But here's LIGO able to detect compact objects like black holes and neutron stars. But here's that space program, which goes from about periods of hours to periods of fractions of a minute, and that's LISA, and we hope that will fly soon. Unfortunately, it probably won't fly until about 2030. Here is a completely different technique. This is a technique that is passive, and what you're doing is you're using pulsars that are distributed all over our galaxy, and you're timing them. All these pulses are putting out very nice, they're like clocks, bing, 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 like that. And if they go variable a little bit, that means that a gravitational wave has come and passed through the galaxy between us and that pulsar. And you can see these slight variations in the arrival rate of these pulses. And if you have enough pulsars, you can then sort of get an idea of where the gravitational wave is coming from and how big it is. And that's the thing that hasn't yet worked, but it will, I hope. And finally, here's the thing that made all the noise about a year ago. I don't know how many of you heard about BICEP and the discovery of gravity. Yeah, a lot of you. And look, I just want to say one thing. They made one mistake. They did an absolutely beautiful experiment, and that experiment's going to work. I mean, they made a factor of 30 improvement in what you can do in that business, looking for the polarization of the cosmic background. And I won't go into that unless you ask me what exactly that means. But anyway, what they messed up was they were a little bit too anxious to publish so fast. And what happens, they didn't go for peer review, which has some merits. In other words, they published And they decided to publish the thing and make a big noise about it, but they didn't go to a journal first and have it reviewed. And that's something we avoided like the plague. Our thing was reviewed, and people would have caught the problem that they had. Okay? But nevertheless, look, I fault them because they're a lot younger than I. So they go, so what happened is that they will succeed, or they have a lot of competition. That field is probably the most interesting one of all. Looking at the primeval gravitational waves that came from Alan Guth's inflation. Imagine such a thing. Okay, that's quantum computing. So here's a summary of what you, I hope you're going to. This is the first direct detection of gravitational waves by instrument, but that's true. There have been other inferred detections of gravitational waves, which are very beautiful. I did give a full talk, you would have heard about that. And I just say, won the Nobel Prize back in 1993, two people who were chasing a pair of pulsars, and they were doing a very careful job of looking how the orbits of the pulsars were going by measuring the pulses from the pulsars. And they were able, the only way they were able to fit the pulses, the time series of the pulses, was by including gravitational radiation reaction on the ice. So they really made, they didn't make a direct discovery, but they made the first measurements of gravitational waves. What we did here, because we have an instrument on the ground, we've opened a new field of astronomy. Because now you can take a look and look all over the universe, look for these gravitational waves. That's something you can't do with those pulsars in that system. So we have a new field, I call that the universe, the dark universe, because if the black holes aren't the only thing, and many other systems. The thing I told you in the early part of the very opening thing I said, the consistency of the Einstein field equations over 16 orders of magnitude. Unbelievable. As far as I'm concerned, that is a theoretical triumph of man's mind, which you cannot fathom. I don't know who you talk to. Somebody. These are more astronomical things. The universe that now we know contains black holes that collide with. People didn't know that. Back when the initial design LIGO, and designed the new detector, we were thinking only of neutron stars. Because we didn't know how to calculate how many black holes there were. So, and the other thing is there seemed to be more black holes than people thought. Those are the two astronomical things that come from this one little observation. And now I want to just show you what is going on. This is very fast. This is these are all the collaborators in their institutions. There's 90 institutions that are mixed up with us, and there are 1,000 scientists mixed up with us. Okay? And here is the group at Caltech, and they happen to be together one day in the lawn. And here's the group at MIT, and some of them are living off in the wings because they weren't there at the time of the pictures, a smaller group. Here the group at the LIGO Livingston site, that's the site in Louisiana, and finally there's the group at the Hanford site. Thank you.